Welcome to the Wild Side. This is your host, Caitlin Kight, and that was Alt J with Lovely Day. And that is the bonus track off of their new album, which is the album from which I'm taking all of the songs that I'm going to be playing on today's show. And none of the titles have anything to do with what I'm actually going to be talking about on the show, which is different from normal. If you're a regular listener, you know that usually I try to find something that fits in with the science and the nature that I'm discussing, but this album has been playing pretty much non-stop since I bought it last week, and I just absolutely love it, and I love Alt J, and so I thought I would share some of their music with you guys and hopefully get you interested in buying the album yourselves. So hopefully you don't mind a little bit of propaganda there as I sell Alt J during today's show. But the theme that I want to discuss is, it's another recent science paper that I'm going to walk you through, and hopefully you think that's kind of an interesting format, although I do hope to change it up a little bit in the future just to throw in some variety. But I find it really interesting to have the chance to read these papers and then to discuss them kind of in the same way that we used to do when I was in a lab group, and we used to discuss each of the sections of the paper and kind of pick them apart, and then at the end look back and see how they all fit together and whether the authors really do what they were setting out to do at the beginning. So this particular study is one that I got a hold of just a couple weeks ago, actually. It is quite new, and I'm not even sure that it's been fully published yet. So scientists sometimes are able to publish things ahead of the actual physical paper release in the journal itself online, and so they're able to get stuff out a few weeks or even sometimes a few months before it's actually in print. And that is certainly the case with this particular paper, which is from the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences from the U.S., and this is a really good publication, and I have mentioned some papers from this in the past. So right off the bat, you kind of know that it's probably a really interesting study, a noteworthy study for some reason or another. And this one is called The Phylogenetic Analysis of Beak and Feather Disease Virus Across a Host Ring Species Complex. So that may not sound like the most exciting of reading, but I promise that it is actually quite an interesting study. And the reason that it's interesting is that ring species and the ring species theory, if you like, is quite kind of an unanswered question in science. And also we know that host-parasite dynamics are kind of, they're not an unanswered question, but there are certainly lots of things we don't yet really know about these dynamics and how they impact other things out in nature. So what are kind of the repercussions of these dynamics between hosts and parasites? And so being able to take these two interesting topics and put them together into a single research project actually makes that project pretty interesting. So I have notes, as I do always, but my notes today are handwritten on a tiny little notebook because I did this during my train ride down yesterday from the end of my holidays. And as you might know, when you were listening to the news, there was a lot of train disruption because someone stole some copper cabling up near London. So it was a bumpy ride. There were lots of delays. I was getting quite tired. So let's hope that I can read all the little scribbles that I was making as I was reading through this paper. All right, so let's start off, as always, with a little bit of introduction and background so that you kind of understand the context in which this study was done. Now, one of the really interesting kind of fundamental questions that we have about biology is thinking about speciation and the process of speciation and what factors promote it. And we know from previous discussions on the show that there are certain sexual factors that can promote speciation. So if females have certain types of preferences, or if animals behave in a certain way or another during the breeding process, this can facilitate matings between some individuals and not others, and that can lead to speciation. We also know that things in the environment can affect speciation. So if you've got a big mountain range, that maybe you've got animals living on the mountain range, and then suddenly there is a volcanic eruption and you've got a big chasm so that the animals can no longer reach each other across that chasm, then you are likely to have two different species emerging, one on either side of the chasm. So we know that the physical environment can have a big impact. And, you know, there are lots of little things like this that you can look at out in the world and kind of get an idea of how these things could promote different species to emerge from a single origin species. But one of the things that is quite unexplored, really, because we don't have a whole lot of places where we can actually find it and look into it in enough detail, is how you can have species that begin to emerge even when there are no physical barriers. Now, one really good example of this is fruit flies that are known to mate on different types of trees and around different types of blossoms and rotting fruit, and they do this at different times of day. So we know that if they are specializing on particular species, then because they have those preferences for those different species, even if they're living together, they're going to be kind of going to different areas of the habitat, and so they won't encounter each other, and so they won't breed with each other. We also know that sometimes if you're a little bit more interested in being active in the day versus in the nighttime or the early morning, then that can also allow you to have speciation. And we've seen these sorts of things in fruit flies. So those are examples of how you can have animals that are living together and yet not actually interbreeding. But there are lots of other cases where you do have this speciation occurring, and there are no really obvious barriers that are keeping the animals from breeding with each other and sharing genes. And people have always wondered how this could possibly be the case, because you would just think that if these things are in the same environment, they're bound to interact with each other and mate, and then eventually kind of have enough of those matings that you get enough hybrids that they can maybe mate with each other and just go off and form their own little species, given enough time. Now, we also know that host pathogen coevolution is something that can affect gene flow in both the hosts and the pathogens. And this is something that we know could potentially drive speciation. So we know that parasites, for example, can alter the fitness and also the survival of their hosts. And this is particularly true in diverging and intermediate lineages. So if you do have kind of a zone where you've got two different species that are interacting with each other, maybe they have a few matings, often the young that they produce are different from their parents because they've got a mixture of genes from each. And so where you might have had some really good immunological genes in either one of the parent species, suddenly you've got something different in the younger species, and so, in the newer species, I should say, and so maybe it's not as resilient in the face of an infection, and so it can succumb more quickly, or it's killed off in some way. So we know that this is potentially something that could drive speciation or prevent it from happening in these regions of overlap. But again, this is not something that's really been looked at in a whole lot of detail. And we also know that pressures from different hosts can drive speciation via specialization of parasites. So we know that within individual organisms, and sometimes even within individuals of a particular species, you can have a huge amount of variation in what the pathogens, the parasites, start to look like, because, you know, they're separated. They're within, you know, my body and not your body, or they're within the bodies of a particular community, you know, maybe here in Falmouth versus over in Penryn versus over in Redruth. And so because you've got that kind of physical isolation, you can begin to have specialization on the characteristics that are found in those places, or maybe even leading to speciation, because you've just got those organisms finding those particular traits and mating with each other and passing on those genes, and then becoming quite different from other parasites that are found within other individuals in other places. And so it's the very same thing that you've got with the hosts happening also in the parasites. It's just for a slightly different reason. Now, we know that these sorts of processes can be studied, and we have in fact done some studies on these, but not too many, because it's quite hard actually to collect all of this data and to have kind of a nice longitudinal sample that allows you to look at these things over a biologically meaningful time period. And it's also not always the easiest thing to find places where you've got hybridizing populations or clinal populations where you've got kind of, maybe they're not completely hybridizing, but you've got these kind of slow shifts where you can see you start off with an A species and you end up with a D species, and maybe everything in between. It's not quite a distinct species, but you can certainly see that there are variations that are leading into that different product or thing that you've got at the end. So you can find these things, but it's not super easy. But when you do, they are really nice natural laboratories for thinking about divergence and speciation and really understanding how does this stuff actually happen in the wild. And one thing that people haven't really explored in much detail at all is how parasitism can promote or penalize and therefore kind of inhibit hybridization. And there have been a few studies in plants and even fewer studies in animals, so only 8 studies total that the authors of this current paper were able to find. And the results of these suggest that there are higher loads of parasites in hybrids than in the parentals, which suggests that maybe the hybrids are somehow more susceptible, which could therefore lead to reduced gene flow and prevent these species from interacting with each other in a sexual way and actually reproducing young and kind of ultimately creating this new species. And one example is in mice, where they found that mice that have these helminths in that are parasitizing them, the hybrids don't do nearly as well as the parentals do. They have kind of a similar thing found in frogs that are infected by lung flukes. But then again, you've also got some studies that have found that hybrids have a lower load than their parents, which could actually facilitate speciation, or at the very least, kind of facilitate their survival in the face of infection. And so you've got some conflicting results here that suggest that maybe we don't fully understand the real nature of these relationships between parasites and hosts and the process of speciation. And some of the reason that we might have some confusion here is that, as I said earlier, the time frame hasn't really been biologically meaningful, and so we don't fully understand what is going on because we haven't watched it from the beginning to the end, or at least, you know, assuming you ever could see it from beginning to end out in nature, but at least kind of a chunk of time that really gives you a good idea of what the process is like. Another problem is that people haven't always explored the other things that can create differences in these parasite loads. So for example, just other genes that are present within the animals or within the things that are parasitizing them. And also the environment. Are there any environmental factors? So physical distance from one place to another and one group of organisms to another. Are these things that could help explain what they're seeing within the infection and the infection patterns? Now we know that parasites can evolve at different rates from their hosts, and so you've got maybe the parasites responding a bit faster to the conditions than the host can respond to the fact that they've got these parasites within them. And that can actually give the parasites a bit of an advantage because they can find a way to exploit that host habitat and kind of create environments that are good for themselves, and they can manage to evade the host defenses, and the hosts aren't able to really keep up. They're always trying to catch up and find a way to get these parasites out of them and to help their immune systems combat these things. And that means that you've got this kind of strange and complicated relationship happening within a population, because you can have these different parasites that are infecting different individuals and different populations, and then the parasites are evolving at different rates than their hosts are. They're maybe even evolving at different rates from the other parasites because the environment within each host might be slightly different. And this can impact overall virulence and also divergence of both the parasite and the host. So all this flexibility can create lots of situations that you wouldn't necessarily predict from the outset, and can have lots more variation than you might originally have thought there could be. So in the current study, they were trying to take all these factors into consideration and think about all the variation that can be introduced by geographic variation, the different amounts of genetic variation, both of a virus and also of a host, and kind of consider all these factors together, how they interact with each other, so not just on their own, but also how they might interact with each other, to drive the potential speciation of different animals from an original parental population. And they were doing this using study organisms, I guess, is the right way to go, but even though the second one's kind of multiple study organisms. So the first is beacon feather disease virus, which is shortcutted to BFDV. So this is a virus I'll talk a little bit more about later, but it's found in birds, which is why I keep referring to animals, even though we do have these processes happening in plants and other species as well. So this is the virus that they were looking at as the infectious agent. And then the host species is something called the Rosella. And the Rosella is a species, or a group of species, I should say, that is found within Australia. And it's a ring species, which means that it is found in kind of this more or less circular shape, where you've got one type of the animal that kind of has an intermediate form and then another form on the end And they all are kind of obviously distinct from each other and yet closely related, and it appears that you have got different species, even though they are very closely related, and are living in conjunction with each other, so kind of right next to each other, and therefore could potentially breed with each other. And I'll try to elucidate a little bit on this and explain a little bit more later when I get into the methods and the materials used in the study. But suffice it to say that you've got all these species that are contiguous to each other, and they could interbreed, and yet they don't seem to be interbreeding. And so actually what you've got, even though you might say that these are one gigantic species that just kind of has a lot of variation, what it really seems is that you've got three subspecies and kind of a hybridization zone where you might have a fourth, potentially, that could be occurring if they are in fact breeding with each other. So this is kind of the area of greatest interest, because this is the zone where you can say, are the infections causing these things to not create a new species if they're hybridizing, or is it actually exactly the reverse? What is the impact, if any, of this pathogen on the existence and potential creation of species in that spot? So BFDV is something that is found worldwide, and it can cause high mortality and is also a conservation threat. And so in addition to kind of being an interesting study organism here for the sake of thinking about speciation, it also has some significance in terms of thinking about how we could use these results to help with conservation efforts of these birds, and also birds that are in captivity, because rosellas and other birds that might be housed with rosellas at some point in an aviary setting are susceptible to these infections. And so if we know more about how these infections work and what damage they can do, we actually could address some of those problems. And it's something that also causes high mortality, which means that it potentially is a really strong selection pressure, and so you would expect to see a real response in the rosella populations that are exposed to these things. Now, it has a single-strand DNA genome with approximately 2,000 nucleotides, and that means that actually it's not something that's really difficult to genotype. You can figure out the sequence of that entire DNA sample, and you could do that for each of the infections for each of the birds, and that allows you to collect quite a lot of data to figure out just how different each of the different strains are in these different animals. And you can see how many strains are there, and then figure out how these things are related to each other, and whether that is related to the speciation of the birds in which the viruses are found. And we do know that there's lots of genetic variation within this particular virus. There's lots of recombination that occurs, which means that it's able to respond pretty well and pretty rapidly to its environment. So you would expect it to kind of begin to specialize within each of these species, and also potentially to help drive some evolution or inhibit evolution, to have a real active impact on the bird species in which it's found. We know also that it has fast evolution in novel environments, so again, you would expect to really see a result if you were to do an analysis on this. And we also know that multiple versions of the very same virus are found within the same individuals. So you've got the viruses kind of mutating and evolving on their own, and doing so in such a fashion that you can have multiple strains even just within a single host individual. Now, the researchers performed their study over an 8-year period, which is actually pretty significant if you think about the fact that these are wild birds. So potentially this is maybe 2 or 3 lifespans of these birds, depending on how lucky or unlucky they are, and it's certainly lots and lots of generations of the virus. So that allows them to have kind of a pretty good idea of what's happening over the lifespan, both literally and kind of figuratively, of an infection and of an individual involved in that infection as well. And they did this also over a 1,200-kilometer study area, so they covered a pretty big expanse, actually, of southeastern Australia, where they were able to sample over the 3 main hosts of this disease, and also the kind of hybridization zones and intermediate zones that are involved in this kind of potential ring species situation that, again, I'll clarify a little bit more in a minute. So they looked at the role of host factors, so things like the subspecies of the bird hosting the infection, the sex of the bird, the age of the bird. They looked at ecology, so the population density, the diversity, the location and time and space, and they were trying to figure out how all of these things might impact the prevalence and the load of the viruses in the hosts in that area. And they also looked at the genome of the virus across different conditions. And all of these things were allowing them to try to figure out whether the phylogeography of the virus supports the likelihood of the ring species concept in this particular species of bird. So they were hoping to figure out if this ring species theory is something that you can verify using viral data, and also if you can in fact do that, what are the sorts of patterns that we would find, and what does all of this say about how the host and the pathogen interact with each other, and how is that related to speciation? So you're asking lots of questions here with actually a fairly simple analysis with just kind of a few constrained factors. So I'll give you a break here to digest all of that, and I'll play another Alt-J song, and then I will come back and tell you about the exact methods used in this particular study. Welcome back to The Wild Side. This is your host, Caitlin Kite, and that was Alt-J, again, with The Gospel of John Hurt. And just before the break, I was talking about the background associated with a new study on beak and feather disease virus in a host ring species complex. And I was probably a bit mysterious about what exactly a ring species is and what the host species is, because I wanted to wait to really describe that in a bit more detail until now, because now is kind of when it matters, because I want to think about the methodology used in this study. So before the break, I mentioned that the study was performed over about 1,200 kilometer region in southeastern Australia. And this is the region in which the rosellas are found. Now, rosellas are a type of parrot species, and they are known as Platyceris elegans, if you would like to have the Latin name, or P. elegans. And this is also known more colloquially as the crimson rosella. And what you've got here is basically a selection of different rosellas that are all found in a particular area, but you've kind of got one merging into another in this kind of ring shape, which is where we get the phrase ring species. So what you've got here in the far southeastern portion of Australia, along the coast is where these things live. So the one that's furthest to the east is called P. E. elegans. And next to it is another species called P. E. melanoptera, and that's kind of on a little island off by itself. And up to the north of that, you've got another type called P. E. adelaide, and this is also known as the Adelaide's rosella. And then across from this, you've got this really interesting, quite a long expanse, but kind of a narrow range of another subspecies called P. E. flaviolus. And this is the one that kind of completes the ring. And the other ones, they kind of go right along the coast, wrapping around. And this one goes overland. And there's a big circle, a big patch right in the middle where there are no parrots whatsoever. So this creates a ring around a patch of habitat in the middle that none of these birds can live in. And this is one of the kind of defining features of a ring species, is that there tends to be something in the middle that causes that ring to form, whether it's a big body of water or a big mountain range, maybe it's kind of deserty, and I don't really know this area of Australia well enough to know what the case is here, but certainly the birds aren't living there. And I know that they are kind of forest and woodland dwellers, so it may be that there simply aren't large enough or many enough trees for them to live in. In any case, P. E. flaviolus kind of finishes the circle, and there are three spots where at the edge, the far southeastern edge of its range, it actually comes right back up against that very first species in the ring, P. E. elegans. And in those three areas, there are the potential for hybridization events to happen. So this is called the WS hybrid zone, because this is the western slopes, and these are the areas where those two different species, and they're known as the terminal species because they're at the beginning and the end of this purported ring, those are the spaces where those guys can potentially interact. So this is where it's most interesting to think about the pathogen-host dynamics. And another area where it's kind of interesting is to look at those intermediate forms, so the ones that are in between P. E. elegans and P. E. flaviolus. So the Adelaide and the Melanoptera, and to think about how do those differ from the kind of terminal species, and also how do those intermediate forms differ from the hybrid forms. And you might begin to think that you would have certain types of similarities and certain types of differences, depending on whether you're thinking about the terminal species or the intermediate species, the hybrid species. And this is exactly what the authors were doing. They kind of made some guesses about what patterns they would see based on those phylogenetic relationships between the hosts. They were thinking, what would we expect to see in the infections, and also what would we expect to see in terms of how these guys are related to one another, because you probably would think that some of them would be more closely related and more similar than others. So the three contact zones were highly sampled because they wanted to try to figure out how much hybridization actually is happening in these areas. And they also tried to get as many animals from other places as well, and in total they got 23 different locations over this 8-year period, and they were targeting the animals using nests, so they went to their nests and were just yanking them off of them, and they also were trying to use some walk-in traps in order to get, in particular, the older individuals and the non-breeding individuals. And they were looking for blood and muscle tissue samples, that's hard to say, so that they could get an idea of the genotypes of the birds themselves, but also of the pathogens within them, of the BFDV. And they also were able to look at the plumage of these birds in order to figure out what age they were and also what sex they were. And these are all the sorts of individual characteristics that they were interested in relating to the infection. So ultimately, they were able to collect 403 different birds that they were able to sample for BFDV infections, and they were able to use antibody tests to look at exposure levels, because it might be the case that some of these animals, they were exposed to the infection, but they weren't actively carrying them. However, the previous exposure meant that their bodies had mounted an immune response, and so they had the antibodies left over inside of them, and this would allow them to figure out just how likely is it that a particular bird is going to come in contact with the disease at some point or another, even if it isn't currently infected with that virus. And they were able to do this in 49 individuals, so it's kind of a subset, and those were the negative individuals, so ones that didn't actually carry the virus, and they were able to do it in 11 positive birds, the ones that were carrying the virus, to try to see whether you had different antibody loads in the positive and the negative individuals. Now, they also sequenced entire infections, so the whole genome, from 40 randomly selected birds from that sample, and these 40 birds cover the three main subspecies plus the more kind of a distant outlier relative that they could compare against. And so the three main subspecies were the elegans, the Adelaide, and the flaviolus. So as I said, the Melanoptera is kind of off on a little island by itself, and it was So it's isolated both physically and genetically, and it had quite a smaller number of individuals, and so that's why it wasn't one of the three main host species that they were looking at here. Now, they also collected data from other samples that had been taken from other birds. So as I said earlier, there was some evidence that this could impact captive birds that these parrots had been housed with, so they were able to take some samples of captive and also wild-caught parrots and other bird species that these animals might come into contact kind of in a normal situation, because this is where you kind of get that applied usefulness of these results. So they then used all of this genetic data to construct phylogenies. And phylogenies are basically family trees, and they did this using four different subsets of the genetic sequences. So they used four different techniques to try to compare and contrast, because if you use different techniques and you get all the same answer regardless of how you do it, then you can be pretty certain that your results are robust. And so that's why they did so many different types of analyses. They also investigated host specificity by looking at endemic Australian species only, and also looking at similarity within and among those different species. So they're trying to figure out to what extent does each of the infections kind of specialize to its own particular host or to its own particular host species and subspecies. do you have a very different virus in each individual, regardless of what population it's in, or do you have a different virus for each subspecies, or do you have the same virus across all the subspecies and all the birds, period? So they're trying to figure out the amount of variation that you have across all the different viral infections. They looked for evidence of recombination within the viruses, so kind of shifting around the gene sequences and becoming different genetically than they were previously. And they did this using a bunch of different analytical techniques, again, in order to try to get an idea of the robustness of their result. And basically, if two or more of these combination investigation techniques suggested that recombination had in fact happened, they decided that it had, and they considered that a positive result. They looked for the relationship between non-synonymous and synonymous mutations, and this was to look at selection pressure. So a non-synonymous mutation, let me backtrack again. So we know that we've got four different nucleotides, A, T, G, and C. And sometimes when you've got one of these substituted for another, you end up producing the same amino acid. And so it doesn't really have any impact on the ultimate product, the ultimate proteins that are created, and the functionality of the gene product, because basically you end up getting the same thing you would have gotten anyway. You can't tell the difference in the final product. But sometimes you've got a substitution where you've got a completely different amino acid that's created when the nucleotide is shifted. And when you've got a different amino acid, you often end up with a very different protein. And that means that everything functions differently or doesn't function at all. And so a non-synonymous one is where you've got that difference and that potential change that can drive really interesting patterns. But a synonymous one is where you're basically exchanging like for like. And so when you can look at the patterns of these things, you can get an idea of whether or not there is likely to be selection happening. If you've got a synonymous mutation, then probably you're not going to really be having any selection pressure because you've got exactly the same thing that you had before. So evolution doesn't really see a difference. But if you've got something different happening, suddenly you've got a new amino acid, a new protein, then selection can say, ooh, this is really bad, this animal's not going to do well, and kind of kill it off. Or you can have selection looking at it and saying, ooh, this thing works very well, this animal is surviving a bit better, and so maybe that's something that now is going to be favorably selected upon and passed down. Now obviously I'm making evolution sound like it has some sort of a goal, and selection isn't a thing that's thinking, but you get the idea that basically you've got things that are working or not working after they are changed genetically, and this is going to impact the survival of an animal. So this is one of the things that they were looking at across all of the subspecies as a whole, and also across each of the individual subspecies, and they're trying to see if there are any differences amongst them. And all of this stuff was used to look for an explanation for two main patterns. First of all, an individual's infection status, so whether or not it had a load and how much of a load there was, and also how heavily loaded that bird was, I guess. So, you know, presence or absence of something and also the extent of something. And the different predictors that they were looking at included subspecies, age, timing in the breeding season, sex of the host, and actually that was it. So just those four factors. And then they created 63 different models that they were using in order to figure out which of these models with different combinations of explanatory factors worked best to explain the amount of variation that they saw across all the different samples. And they had this number because they had all the different species subsets, they had the single interaction, so just the effect of subspecies on, for example, load or prevalence, and then they also looked for two-way interactions, which means that they're looking at how age and sex, for example, both combine to impact load or prevalence. So you've got all these different factors that they're shifting around and trying all these different combinations, and so ultimately they had 63 different models to use to explore. And they also took into account the source of the DNA, so whether it was muscle or blood, the geographical location from where these things were sampled, and also the year in which they were sampled, because as I said, they did this over 8 years. and they performed basic repetitions of analyses in order to check for the effects of the DNA source and also the sampling location, just to make sure that their methods weren't influencing their results. And the one final thing that I'll mention is isolation by distance, or IBD. And this is basically looking for the effects of distances on variation and therefore potentially speciation. And I'm talking about physical distances here. So you might expect that the farther away things are, the more likely they are to be genetically distinct. And they were looking at this by kind of comparing these genetic distances between the virus sequences with the geographic distances between the different sampling locations. And they're trying to see whether genetic variation mapped to geographical variation as well. So, what did they find? Well, the virus was detected in all of the subspecies, but at different levels. So, depending on what subspecies you were likely to have more or less of a particular infection. So the most phenotypically distinct species, the crimson and the yellow, the two, the terminal species in that ring complex, had the highest prevalence and the highest load. And the phenotypically and geographically intermediate forms were the ones that had the lower load. So in this case, it looks like potentially being a hybrid, kind of being in between, is actually good for you because you have a lower load of the virus. Now, prevalence was best predicted by subspecies identity, by date, by host sex, and also by an interaction between the subspecies and the date. So there seemed to be a little bit of variation over time. The load was best predicted by subspecies identity, again, age of the bird, sex, and the subspecies by age interaction. Now, the extreme forms, again, had the higher load, and the subadults, so the younger birds, tended to have a higher load than the adults, which is kind of interesting. And maybe that's because, actually, it kills off the adults, and so you just end up having more juveniles that have a load just because they haven't died yet. It's hard to say, but the subadults did have a different pattern than the adults, but that was only really true in the two extreme subspecies and not in the intermediate forms. They also found that males tended to have a higher load than the females, which is another kind of interesting pattern, and maybe has something to do with kind of the hormonal differences between males and females, or potentially even the behavioral variations. But again, I think probably the physiological response there, the hormones, is a bit more likely. Now, BFDV did not seem to be related to geographical location for either load or prevalence. So that's kind of an interesting thing that suggests that the variation has more to do with the birds themselves than where the birds are found. The infection was not related to community diversity or composition, so there don't seem to be strong ecological impacts on the infections. The prevalence was not related to bird density, but was negatively related to load. So this is a potentially interesting result, but then they did it a second time using a slightly different technique and found the opposite. So they're not really sure that this is actually a pattern that's that they can really comment on yet, because they might need to do some further research to really figure out what's going on there. Only one individual actually was carrying BFDV antibodies, and this was actually quite a weak signal. So that's really interesting that it doesn't seem to be a case where you've got an individual that's being exposed to the virus and creating the antibodies and then clearing it out. Basically, they seem to have it all of the time and not to have kind of gone through and cleared the cleared them out of their system and lived in the aftermath of that. So either they are pre-infection or they are during infection, but they don't really seem to be post-infection, which is potentially an interesting thing to kind of follow up on in the future. Now, phylogenetic analyses suggest that structure is related to both host species and subfamily. And when I say structure, I mean the structure of the family tree. All of the infected Rosellas seem to have a shared BFDV ancestor based on the family tree that they came up with. And this seems to be potentially related to some isolates from New Zealand. So maybe there was an ancestral bird that that had a population that kind of spanned both of those areas, and that is where the Rosellas originated their particular relationship with this species. Now, there seem to be five major groups that fell out of the phylogeny, and there's one that's really massive that is basically three of the different subspecies in that ring complex. You've got a couple of really small ones and then a couple of intermediate ones, and they're all combinations of the three main subgroups, so that you don't have kind of a really obvious phylogeny where you've got all of the P.E. elegans, all of the Adelaide, all of the Flaviolus, and so on. You've got kind of mixtures of these things with one that was just really large and encompassed all three of them in one particular branch, and then a couple others that had mixtures of just two. So it's interesting that you don't have a really obvious relationship between the viral phylogeny and the bird phylogeny going on here. There is evidence of recombination in 12 of the sequences, or 30% of the sequences that they looked at from the viruses, so this suggests that these things are evolving and changing up their DNA quite a bit. And this was found in all but the western slope subspecies. So for some reason there's quite a lot of viral variation happening within each of the different subpopulations, but not where you've got that hybridization zone between the two terminal species, and that's kind of an intriguing pattern. They did also find some evidence for weak but still significant isolation by distance in all of the coding regions of the virus, and this was true regardless of the analysis type. So this does suggest that the kind of physical space is related, physical distance, I should say, is related also to genetic distance of the viruses. So how closely they are positioned physically is something potentially driving how closely they are related genetically. And there were signs of all three different types of selection, neutral, positive, and negative, depending on which group of birds they were looking at and also which region of the viral sample they were looking at. So neutral selection would be where basically this is a mutation that's neither good nor bad, it's just kind of hanging in there for some reason or another, maybe because it's associated with something else, and so it just kind of is it's proliferating in a population, but not because it's actively being selected on itself or really conferring an advantage or a problem. Positive selection would be where something is actually having a good impact on something, and so therefore you see it happening more and more often. And negative selection would be where something is becoming less common in a population because it is damaging to the birds. And they found evidence, as I said, of all three of these things happening, just depending on which particular sample they were focusing on. So there's quite a lot going on between the host and the pathogen, and that's having a real impact on what they were finding out in the wild. So, what were the overall patterns that you can take if you stand back and look at all of these data together? Well, subspecies was the most important predictor of prevalence and also of load. And the terminal species had higher levels of the virus than their intermediates did. And other factors, so things like environment and viral phylogeny, didn't really explain these patterns very much. So this suggests that subpopulations are related to host-parasite dynamics, and specifically that infections can drive the otherwise difficult to explain maintenance of species in this Rosella ring complex, and potentially in other ring complexes as well. So maybe this is the answer to how and why these ring complexes can form, and you've got these hybrid zones, but you don't actually have hybrids occurring. You've got these different distinct species that are living side by side and not really interacting with each other, which you would expect that they might. So one of the questions the authors ask is, are the hybrids more resistant to infection? And this is kind of particularly rare in animals, but it is still possible. And all the animals seem to be equally exposed, which suggests that they are in fact resistant rather than susceptible. So it's not that they are particularly likely to get infected. It's that once they are infected, they're particularly likely to be okay and then survive to be sampled by the researchers. Now, there could be lower selective pressures that would favor hybridization, which would explain the maintenance of the western slope birds and also kind of the creation of a selective bridge between the two terminal species. However, the authors do recognize that susceptibility, which I just kind of now swept aside, is still potentially an option. So they clearly didn't think that this was the likely thing, but they do acknowledge that it is possible. And they thought that maybe the hybrid birds and the western slopes birds might get more BFDV, which would lead to greater mortality of the infected birds, which would therefore alter the population from which you're sampling. And so you would just have the same results, but for a very different reason. So in this scenario, basically you would have the extreme forms of the species being more tolerant than those hybrid variations. Now, a greater susceptibility could happen if the genetic admixture begins to erode complexes that are needed for immune function. And I kind of hinted at this earlier on when I was giving some of the background. And usually you've got greater heterogeneity and heterozygosity, so just kind of the variations of all the different genes that you've got mixed together, leading to a lower prevalence and a lower load, which is what they saw here. So that actually does support their hypothesis a little bit. So if you stand back and look at all these patterns, what do they say about the whole idea of the ring species complex? Well, the authors say that their study suggests that host pathogen dynamics and also the variations within them can be used to explore possible ring species and help determine how much gene flow there really is. So they think that their technique really does explain some of the genetic relationships between all of these different closely living but distinct subspecies of the Rosella. And basically they say that you need to find three different patterns to support the idea of a ring species. The first is genetic discontinuity, where the terminal species meet. And they did, in fact, find that here. So they found that there was no recombination in the BFDV sequences in the western slopes birds, where you've got those two terminal species that are finally coming together at the either end of the ring, if you like. And also extreme difference between the WS birds and the crimson Rosella. So kind of the hybrid, the potential hybrid, and the parent species. And so you've got genetic discontinuity occurring across the hybrid zone. The second thing is that most distinct forms should be connected by a series of intermediates circling the unsuitable habitat. So as I said, this kind of forms a circle, and right in the middle there's a patch where there's nothing found. None of these birds are living there. And in fact, that is what they found. So the virus variants represented all three main clades, and they happened in that circular fashion, exactly matching where the Rosellas were found. Finally, they also say that there should be a pattern of IBD around the ring. So this is the relationship between distance. And they did in fact find that, but it only accounted for part of the variation in their sample, which suggests that not only do you have this kind of host pathogen dynamic occurring in this relationship of the hybridization, or lack thereof, I should say, but there are also some other processes that are leading to variation in the genetics that they were focusing on here. And the current patterns could also be influenced by things like range expansions, alternative sources of ancestral infection, or other things like that could not match with the assumptions that they were making when they did these analyses. And so you'd have to go in and collect some additional natural history and ecological data in order to really parse that out and figure it out. But basically, all three of their things are pretty much in support of the fact that this species, the Rosella, is in fact a ring species. And in fact, the pathogen appears also to have some of those very same patterns. And it may even be the very first time that a pathogen has been found to have a kind of an analog to the ring species concept that we find in the hosts that we're talking about here, so things like plants or animals. So we find that not only do the larger, the megafauna and megaflora have these sorts of things, but potentially the microscopic species within them could also follow their footsteps and behave just in the same way that their hosts do, which is quite an intriguing thing that hasn't really been observed before in the past. And all of this shows that it is in fact possible for divergence to occur even when you've got gene flow even though you've got species that are living right next to each other and maybe look like each other, act like each other, they can breed with each other if they want, and yet we find that you do have these birds and other species like this maintaining these distinct genetic populations, even if they do every now and then kind of share genes with each other with a few little breeding attempts. So this is quite an interesting thing that suggests that, you know, just this one thing, this infection by another species, can really have a huge impact on the host and on, in fact, multiple different hosts that are closely related. So that is a very interesting advance in host pathogen dynamics, but also in speciation and thinking about how these really huge and important and impressive processes can happen out in the wild, and how all of that can be driven by just something that you can't even see with your naked eye. So hopefully you found that enlightening and interesting and are ready for one more bit of an Alt-J song to close out the show. So I only have a minute left, so I'll hurry up and put it on. And I hope you like this album as much as I do, and I hope you now like pathogen dynamics as much as I do. So I'll talk to you next week.